Jamaica, very early on, before independence, started to look at developmental models, and you know the Puerto Rican model about industrialization, liberalization, and stuff like that. But as part of the process of industrialization, they set up an industrial park. But the very first factory that got set up in the industrial park was a record pressing plant. So, no big surprise that in fact the Jamaican music industry and so on grew and grew very fast, because whether by accident or otherwise, our record pressing plant was the very first industrial investment that they had in the industrial park. Good. But with the export of Jamaican migrants went the export of Jamaican music to the UK. And so in the end, you had Chris Blackwell, who used to actually sell records to England, exported them. He eventually decided he might as well go to the UK and set up in the UK as an importer of Jamaican music and ultimately a producer of music from Jamaica. And that is how the mini small My Boy Lolly Pop in 1964-65 became a hit, and then subsequently the Bob Marley, you know, phenomenon in which he took Marley and made him a global star and so on. So that's but of course, all of that built on a Jamaican and Caribbean presence in the UK, and the music, of course, if you, as it were, selling and pushing the language and the culture as well. You then now switch to the kind of, I'm jumping all the time, but I say, you end up with the classical era of Jamaican popular music globally with reggae. Well, that particular period was managed very carefully because of the need perceived by Chris Blackwell, who was a major packager and marketer, to ensure that the music or the lyrics were accessible. And so Marley, originally the Wailers and subsequently Bob Marley, they were encouraged, cajoled, to ensure that only in the choruses would you get Jamaican language, right? But that in the verses, they would be in English. That was part of the marketing plan. That was what it was, so that the world can supposedly understand the language and the music and so on. Well, that's one level of kind of consciousness and awareness, but it's when you switch to the 1980s onwards, and the shift in Jamaica is towards that song, right? Towards a form of musical, people would even argue, of musical, but basically, the musical range of the Nassau song is very limited, two or three notes very often, is all that is involved. But of course, the complexity comes with the rhythmic pattern of the oral delivery of speech. So that in a sense, dancehall is not really music. It is a lot more an oral performance, right? Involving the rhythmic presentation of spoken lyrics. That's certainly one way to view it. So that you're dealing with a rhythm and you're dealing with spoken language performed rhythmically to a rhythm track that can in fact be used for 50 or 100 other performances. Now why would somebody prefer this particular performance to the other? Answer that the artistry involved in the oral performance is what makes the difference. And of course all of this, and once you focus on the fact that it's the oral performance and the oral performance of language, and as well that the artists are producing and performing for the first instance in Jamaica and the market, then understandably you notice that the dancehall lyrics are all in Jamaica. Now, in all of this, of course, you've got the Caribbean stroke, Jamaican stroke, whatever kind of presence in the metropole, spreading, of course, from and extended from London to New York, Toronto, etc., etc. And the emergence, certainly by the end of the 20th century, of a sense that there is a Caribbean diasporic linguistic presence, not just simply from people who come directly from the Caribbean, but by their descendants and so on. And that now starts to, particularly with the rise of hip-hop in the United States. There's a kind of overlap between dancehall and hip-hop, and all of this, a continuing argument about who started this thing, where the Jamaicans started and the Yankees copied, or vice versa, because some of the earliest hip-hop improvisers had were either Jamaican or had Jamaican origins and so on. So that's a kind of argument that the musicologists can engage themselves in. But the most important point is that Jamaican language is then, along with African-American vernacular English, end up being the two competing languages in that area of popular music where rhythmic presentation of spoken language is dominant, right? Whether it be hip hop or dancehall. So, and then the other thing that happens is, of course, with the communities becoming much more consolidated and much more confident, you get as well the image of these communities, Jamaican, Caribbean, whatever you want to call it, as being desirable, as being imitatable, and so on. And then, and having associated with this street credibility, and you get the artists, say for example, African American artists, then of course becoming attracted both to the music form and the language. And so, in the last 15 years or so, you've had masses of collaborations between very big name North American black artists in the US with much, much smaller name. Jamaican artists, notably the one that I like to refer to, the Alicia Keys and Baby Sham collaboration and Ghetto Story. Interesting because in the performance, Alicia Keys, when she shares a chorus with Baby Sham, sings like a Jamaican. He never sings like a Yankee at all, not a Jamaican, right? But the same where the influence is going, that the Caribbean language forms within these diasporic contexts have become very attractive, and non-native speakers and non-native users are learning these vernacular languages because, of course, they represent something that they identify.